And we can talk about some of that goal setting or how to, you know, maintain mindfulness and get your work done, things like that, things like that. So I'm Suzan-Lori Parks, this is Watch Me Work, and anyone who's never been here before, we will tell you, and the people online, JB's behind the camera, hooking us up to the world, and I have a cold. And for those of you who don't know what this is a play, and first we do the action, which is we work together for 45 minutes, and then we do the dialogue, which is you and me talking about your work and your creative process. And the folks online who are watching online and might have a question about their work and their creative process can tweet us at
Watch Me Work SLP with hashtag new play.
I'm gonna try that. Watch Me Work SLP with hashtag new play. And you can even do it. And you can even do it. You know, after the show is over, if you have a question, you can tweet us, and we'll get it next week, and we'll answer your show live from the lobby of the Public Theater where we are at right now. So, did I forget anything? Goody, I'm so glad. So we're going to work. I'm going to type some on my typewriter today, and also write some by hand. And we're going to set our collective meter. We're going to set our timers, and Patty. Patty's name. Patty is the riding shotgun to the shotgun, and she's here too, helping us out today. So we're going to set our timers, and we're going to begin to work. It's been so long. I know, shaking off the rust. So what did we say? 45 minutes we're going to do? Okay. All right. All right. Let's get started. Thank you.
I Thank you.
some plays where they happen together.
Slow when I'm adapting a text because I want to find everything just right, and I'm not sure if I'm confusing just general progress with like stopping myself perhaps a bit too much. How, like for example, like in the way I'm adapting it, like this one section of the original work doesn't coincide with what I want to do with the piece. So how do you sort of negotiate that if you're in a situation like that? Would you try to write sort of pawing to the poem? Would you go back to the poem more, or would you go back to what you want to do more?
Right. So Dan is an acting person because he has a really wonderful voice and projects beautifully. So you heard his question. So you're adapting a poem into a story.
Yeah.
And but you're wondering if you seem to have maybe gone. But it's an assignment, you said.
Yeah.
Meaning you're going to turn it in, it's a work for hire or an assignment, so
it's
like
a
grade situation or a...
No grade, it's like a correspond writer's workshop.
Okay, so basically you can do whatever you want. Is that...
Sort of, they gave me a prompt, and I guess I could do whatever I want with it, but it's good to stick to the original, I think.
Sure. You're doing the assignment, but what
right.
I'm saying is that if you veered off into...
It wouldn't be the end of the world.
Exactly. Because like if I would work on Porgy and Bess, if I turned them into, you know, Bess and Frida, you know, they'd be like, you kind of, you know, somewhere where we weren't hoping you would go. So that's why I'm asking. So you could turn it into Bess and Frida. Frida is great, right? Bess
right.
and Callow, I don't know. But anyway, you could turn it into Bess and Frida or whatever. You could go off the road and it would be okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I would do two things. When I'm adapting, I try to stick. When I'm adapting, sticking close to it until you find so many things sort of leading you away. And if it's not a work for hire, meaning you can do whatever you want,
right.
kind of thing, then I would go ahead and go with your instincts.
Uh-huh.
You know. But this is what you have to ask yourself as you're kind of veering off the yellow brick road into the forest.
Uh-huh.
The lights are getting darker. The trees in your hands. And you have to ask yourself, am I just veering off the path because I want to do something different? And you have to ask yourself, what are your motives? Am I truly being led by the muse? Or am I just going, I want to do whatever I want, like a 2-year-old?
Right.
Okay. So you have to ask yourself that question. If you're truly being called by the muse or the sirens, that's not a good analogy, but you know what I mean? If you're truly being led by the spirit to discover something that is not totally with the original work, then go for it. Now, it's different with a riff. So you're doing an adaptation. It's very different because I've done a lot of riffs. The Porgy and Bess is an adaptation. Your Eyes Are Watching God, which I did, it's an adaptation. I've done riffs, like using the Scarlet Letter to write some plays,
right.
which have very little to do with the Scarlet Letter. Very little. So, that sounds very different from what you're doing. If you're doing a riff, you just do whatever you want from the jump.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
I think we should go. But what's the strongest choice, ask yourself?
The original story, the story of it, I guess, is like there's an empty room and this guy's deciding whether or not to leave it, and then he leaves it. And then I've sort of changed it to this like coke-filled boozer where empty is sort of in the moral sense, and he leaves as well. But I don't know how it's working with the action the way I'm adapting it. So
the original.
It's called The Empty Room, I think.
Oh, it's called The Empty Room.
There's something there for you, I don't know much about it.
You read?
Yeah.
Is it recent?
Relatively recent, yeah.
It sounds, and your take on something. Okay, let's just, you know, keep leaning into what, you know, that's just a jumping off point. So you're doing a riff instead of an adaptation. You know, you're just kind of, you know, making your own thing. Like, you can think of, here's one, My Favorite Things by John Coltrane. That's an adaptation, you could say, because you can really hear the melody of the original Rodgers and Hammerstein, My Favorite Things, in his song, right?
Right.
But you could think of Charlie Parker's Now Is the Time. That's a riff on You're in the Army Now. You're in the Army Now. I mean, that's what I think. You're in the Army Now. You'll never get rich by digging a ditch. You're in the Army Now. Well, that's he more like stepped out and like, that you can't, you don't readily recognize it. Like John Coltrane's My Favorite Things.
Right.
Okay? So it sounds like you might be doing a Charlie Parker.
Yeah. Thank you.
Continue. Finish it. You're almost done. How many things do you have?
Well, it's like in this one, there's this. He's like trying to get with this guy, and then that's what's like the turning into meaning. And so I don't know. It's microfiction, so I don't know how much dialogue to use. And then when I do use dialogue, and I have this guy next to him is sort of bugging him, sort of personified as a hand. And I don't know how to further the exposition of it without fleshing him out more than just a hand.
Right.
So, I don't know, it's just like...
How long is it?
Less than 1,000 words. Yeah, it's difficult. But I'm getting somewhere, I think.
Because you don't need to write 1,000 words.
Right, yeah. It's a challenge, though, because you need to make sure that they're the right words.
Always.
Always, but it's best to do.
Always. Always. Even if we have a million words. I mean, I don't know how attentive, you know, James Joyce was when he wrote about Ulysses, but I think probably he was real anal. Shakespeare. And you think he's like, hit me the sixth long. Who gives a fuck? I'm just gonna cry. Don't you think he like labored on pieces?
I don't know I feel very lost right now. So I don't even know what question I want to ask.
What you
saying? Harrison. I'm just tackling something very big that I've never done before. And it's about something very big in my life. So it's kind of like all sorts of bigness in many different categories. That are just, I feel like I'm swimming in mud. Like trying to figure out what the story is, what even I have to play with, like what are the characters? I don't even know what paints I'm using. I don't know what the palette is yet. I don't know how to do the things that I want to do in it. But I like the idea. And I feel like I have something to say. But I just...
Can everybody hear Garrison talk? Okay, keep going. Here's a question, not knowing anything about it, other than it's enormous.
Yeah.
And you're excited about it. Those are two very important things. Your excitement will help you keep going. You know?
Yeah.
And the enormity is overwhelming. It helps you not want to do it. It's huge.
That's true.
It's huge, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So there's that, how do you climb Everest? You know, one step at a time.
Yeah.
So is there any, I don't know, I have never climbed Everest actually, but
yeah.
I imagine, is there, what you might want to do, Garrison, is on a separate piece of paper, you know, either by hand, journal writing, just get out of your computer for a minute if it's on your computer, step away and get into a notebook, and handwrite the ways that you can make it into bite-sized pieces.
I've done, I'm very good at, I'm very type A, I'm very, I can list things like nobody's business.
Well, that's going to help you.
I've been working on it in chunks,
guess now I feel like I haven't done the homework, and so I've written the parts I want to write. But now in terms of like getting the whole thing done, there's like I haven't done, like I need to write these scenes that I don't necessarily want to write in order to even know all the characters that would be in the scenes that I do want to write. It's just...
So can you break, so how do you, so when you have a scene that you don't want to write, or a chapter that you don't want to write, how do you make that a smaller project, less overwhelming project? You might, either on the computer or in your notebook, write a summary of the scene. So right, so you say you have 8 scenes that you don't want to write,
yeah.
So you might write summaries. So, well, this scene's going to be about this and this and this and this.
Yeah.
And this scene's going to be about this and this and this. Or even better, get 8, get 3x5 cards, index cards, small paper, and a big pen, like a magic marker, like a Sharpie, and write down what those scenes are about. Not what they're about, not meaning theme, not meaning what the dramaturgs would talk about in the coffee after your play is brilliant on Broadway. It's not that. You're talking about what happens in the play, what happens in the scene, okay? In this scene, you know, Jeff says to Alice, you know, blah, 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 whatever, okay? So those are really helpful too, because that makes it even smaller. So you have several of those cards, and you might put them up on your wall in your apartment or on a bulletin board, you know, a place that's private where you work, or just carry them around in your pocket or in your backpack, and just look at them every once in a while. That's a way of making the task less overwhelming, more manageable. Because a lot of times we have these tasks and it's so like, oh my gosh, it's so much to do, you know? I've written the 10 parts that I want to write, and now I've got 10 parts that I don't, oh no, and they involve la 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 la, you know? Type in about like that.
Yeah.
Might be helpful. And then just kind of one at a time. If you've got that type A or whatever type it is, type D, who knows? But
that's
good. It's going to help you. That's the head that you're going to use to make it smaller and smaller and smaller. And we lower the bar. We lower the bar so low that it's easy to step over.
Yeah.
Right? And then we go from there. You know, because we just get stalled when the bar is too high.
You talked about the beginning of the process. What are some ways you work after you have a draft that you completed and you feel pretty good about it, but you know it's not done yet? What do you do then?
What's your name?
I'm Daniel.
Hi Daniel. Hey Daniel.
Yeah.
Hey Daniel. So you've got, I'm just guessing, you've got something, you've got a couple of drafts of?
Yeah.
You feel pretty good about?
Pretty good.
Okay.
It's not done.
Okay. You have friends?
Yeah.
Have they read your work to you?
Yeah.
Okay. So did you ask them for feedback?
Yeah.
Did you?
That's why I got to like, you know, draft 2, draft
good.
3.
Good. Okay.
But it's not done.
Okay. So what are you thinking that you need to do to get it done?
Well, that's about the point for inspiration. Having it read out loud is very helpful. I've been able to listen to and so I suppose that's one next step. Like that's an intermediate next step I do, is have people read out loud and listen to
it. Your friends have read it out loud, so would you have them read it out loud again?
Oh right, sorry, they haven't read it out loud. So there's the thing. So okay, that's an immediate next step.
Well, if you feel comfortable, so they've read it in the privacy of their own pod. Aha. So they might they come together and in your living room or snacks,
yeah.
They've got to provide snacks, preferably non-alcoholic, so they stay to, you know, pull it together so they can read. You might give it to them so they can read it beforehand,
yeah.
Once, and then they come and they read it live in your living room. That might be helpful.
Great.
That's why I asked is because most people work differently from me. So I started by asking what might be helpful to you. What I do is a little different. But it might be helpful.
Yeah.
I sit around the house when no one's watching, and I read it out loud to myself and act out all the parts. You guys, oh, stop! You guys weren't supposed to walk in that way! That was production. That was like, oh my God. And that's where you're going to go so that might be helpful. I sit around the house and read it out loud, and I got all the parts. I do it myself. I don't invite my friends over. I have friends, but I don't invite them over to read it out loud. I do it myself. Because I work it, I feel like I'm more like a musician working and reworking the tune, more like a composer. So when I think of it, not to compare myself to these guys are kind of mine, like a Coltrane, like a Mozart, like Bach. They can hear the music in their head. They didn't have to invite the orchestra in. Come on, guys, let me hear it. I don't know what it sounds like, you know? So I really train my ear so I can hear it. And then, of course, when I get to the actors, then it's like, icing on the gravy kind of thing. Oh, wow. Yeah. You see what I'm saying? So you might want to try to read it out loud on your... Have you read it out loud already?
No, I suppose I haven't. Yeah. I mean, not literally out loud. I feel like it's out loud.
Yeah, are you standing up when you read it?
No.
Are you doing the thing? Are you like...
Yes,
well, yeah, because you're practicing. You're seeing what it feels like. Because language comes from... Well, in my opinion, language comes from the body. Language is a physical act. And the physical act doesn't only reside up here. So, you know, people are, I mean, they don't always move like that, except maybe in my life. But it always comes from that, you know what I mean? So you're gonna wanna maybe be on your feet, you don't have to do the whole thing in one fell swoop. You can do a scene at a time, you know? Do it, do all the characters, feel what they're like, because that's gonna inform the language. And then you can get your friends together. But I skip the friends together part. I just hire people.
Oh,
yeah. Anybody else? Like a flower. Like a flower.
In the spring.
In the spring.
No, that synapses well with something I've been thinking about. Right? So like a flower in the spring is possibly one of the tritest metaphors you could think of. Or one cup, right? Or rather, it's conventional, something that springs to mind easily. And I'm finding, in my writing right now, I love narrative, I love conventional narrative. It's not to say like the lonely play, but there's a story with characters you can follow, And I'm finding I really want to get out of that. Maybe it's just because it's I still want characters and a story you can follow, but in terms of conventional forms, in terms of plays that take place in houses, I feel like sometimes I'm thinking, oh, something that can be produced. I want to experiment in school, and I'm finding myself a little stuck, I suppose, and I'm trying to think of examples or exercises or source material that I can kind of bathe in for a little bit to ease that transition and improve the statement. That makes any sense.
So you set your plays in houses and in rooms. Some of my favorite plays are set in houses.
Oh, absolutely.
But you can do but you want to do something. You want to expand.
You want
to grow a little bit.
Feel like I'm just not say writing the same, but just kind of using some of the same
structure. It's good to be observant though. You're onto yourself like that. I would say, I don't know what to. I read stuff like Zen and the Art of Archery. This has nothing to do with writing, but these are the kinds of books I read. Mindfulness, meditation. Do you meditate? Do you have a meditation practice?
I don't have a meditation practice.
Right, so you could get one. I know exactly where you can get one. It's free, and it will be delivered to you. What time do you get up?
It varies.
Okay, it's delivered to you upon when you get up quite a bit. There it is. Oh my God, it's free. You sit there. You have a timer?
Yes.
Good, 15 minutes. Or 10, or 5, lower the bar. And you just sit there on a cushion or a pillow, not in your bed, get out of your bed. Sit on the floor, or a couch or a chair or something where it's comfortable, and meditate. So cultivate mindfulness. That small, still voice within. Not the voice that's saying, oh, Ricardo, you're full of shit. You don't need to write the thing. Not that. That's not the small, still voice within. That's the stupid voice that needs to talk to the hand. Okay? All right? But that kind of thing. Or just, have you ever set a play in a field?
Yes.
Okay, and that's conventional?
I do.
Have you ever set a play using a historical character?
Yes.
Okay, that's, yeah, that's great. Well, then, I mean, I don't know. Have you ever set a play with Smith? Have you ever written about yourself?
No. I mean,
okay.
Every play in some ways, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
But,
it's tricky because I'm the opposite writer of you. I have never tried to do anything. I've never willfully tried to do anything different. I've never tried to write differently than what I've written before. But, strange enough, all my plays are different from the one that's written. I can't seem to repeat myself. Even, you know, I don't try, but I don't not try either. So, and maybe I am writing about the same thing, and maybe I don't care. You know what I mean? Maybe even that's your thing. You know? Because some people say, yeah, I'll do something I've never done before. I'll set my play underwater. I'll have someone defecate on stage because I've never had anyone defecate on stage in my play. And maybe that's interesting. You know? Have you ever played musical instruments? You've written musicals. You've done that. Have you ever played musical instruments on stage? So you do that. Okay, so see, that was it. Well, what are you looking for exactly? You have to ask yourself, what are you looking for? Because, you know, what Dorothy said, you know, there's no place like home. No, you know, what was she looking for? She found her own backyard. I mean, or Rilke said, you can know the world without ever leaving your doorstep. Sometimes you have to be comfortable with, okay, so this is the way, this is the kind of thing I write. I kind of write a certain kind of way, you know. What are you looking for? Maybe you can find it within the forms and things that you do. Maybe.
Yeah, I just want to. Part of it is I want to challenge existing theatrical forms. And I think that there's something about rewriting that we can continue to expand upon. I don't know what that is. So it's a big question. It's a larger question. I guess the question is I don't think I've got something to think about.
Writing other languages? I didn't say that. Don't ever call me that. Anybody else have a question or an answer? You're laughing. Do you have an answer? Oh, we have 2 minutes. 2 minutes. JB says we're 2 minutes. That's a signal. I thought I was saying peace, but actually, let's wrap it up, girl. We've got 2 minutes.
Well, it's been very exciting to introduce to watch you work and to hear everybody. I've been writing for the holidays quite a bit. And I'm hoping that I'm going to be able to make something, little pieces of my story that I can do short performances of.
Very cool.
That's my statement. I'm sorry I don't have a question.
Very cool. No, that's it. We want answers. We like answers. That is great. Are you going to come back?
Absolutely.
And what's your name?
My name is Rosalyn.
Rosalyn. It's a character. Right, good. Come back.
It's quite looking into your page. Oh, so much. I'm glad it's written. We have a great cast. That is, we have amazing people.
Yes, Carol.
Aside from writing, things have been coming to me in song lately.
Oh, cool.
You know, and I down. Sometimes like your musical episodes at the same time,
right.
Cool. Like get to it, right? But I've been writing songs.
Right.
That's great. And that is giving me some certain just to let myself write that song.
Right.
Whatever. It's like taking notes. Whatever I'm hearing, right? See what it is.
I'm sorry?
Do you write music?
Yeah.
I mean, it's...
Do you record it into your phone? Do you sing it to your phone? Do you have a phone you can sing it to?
I have a recording device.
Well, let me talk about this. Right. Yes, so sing into your recording device.
What you said about writing the lyrics down anyway. Very good.
Oh yeah, yeah, sure. Write the lyrics down and even if you don't remember the tune or even if you don't, you know, one or the other, get it down somehow is helpful. And you know, I mean, there's some songs in the new play. They don't have to be like, it doesn't have to be, you know, whatever, Bach or whatever. You know, it doesn't have to be Bach. I mean, Bach was Bach, so hopefully we don't have to do that.
No, and it can't, I mean, usually if I, let's say I encounter a character during the day,
right,
you know, or something, and usually that the B will come out in the story or something. Suddenly, lyrics.
That's great.
So I'm not quite understanding why, and I'm not asking, I'm just following.
That's really good, Carol. You're following. So, like I said, mindfulness, and see what comes up, and then follow. That's what, if you created a part of your day where you were sitting and cultivating mindfulness, that's where a lot of the stuff, think of it as the bottom of a lake. You know, leaves, you know, the bottom of a lake, it's very bushy and very soft, and you allow everything to settle so you can see clearly. A lot of times the lake, it's all like this, and you can't really see because it's all murky. But if you cultivate that mindfulness, things will settle down, and then you'll be able to see clearly, and you'll be able to see what's there. Yeah. And I think your ideas might start coming from that. From your own mind, instead of from some exercise that I gave you to. Well, you know, reading Zen in the Art of Archery. Okay. What's the sign right there? Much better than that. Okay, bye. Thank you for coming.
How are you doing?
I'm well. How are you?
Good. I'm going to see your show tonight.
Oh, you're seeing your show?
Yeah. Yay. I was actually just about to buy my tickets. So. Should I buy at the door?
Well,
like
you buy,
yeah,
but if you, yeah, we're not sold out, and honestly, if you buy at the door, we get all of the money, so we wrap
up. Fuck yeah, great, I'll do that.
Yeah. Here.